Now, the secret to power, which I'm going to tell you right now, is very, very simple. It's waiting upon the Lord. He commanded them to wait. Here's why. Go with me, please, in your Bible, Psalm 62, verse 1. It says, truly, my soul waiteth upon God. So I want to talk to you about this, because if you really want to have power in your life, that's how it starts. Simple, difficult. Nobody wants to do it because the flesh hates it. They that wait upon the Lord. Now, Marie, would you mind getting my phone? Just go get my phone, please. If you have it, turn it on for me. I want to just show you what I do. It's so simple, so simple. I did it while I was here, night before last, and again last night after service. This is the key to power. If you really want me to give it to you, I will. You accept it, not accept it, that's up to you. The Bible says, my soul waits upon God, because from him comes my salvation, meaning my deliverance. Now, what is it to wait? Well, the Bible says, wait upon the Lord. Well, but what is it to wait? It's to wait. Many preachers have messed it up. Well, waiting means minister. No, it doesn't. It means wait. You look at the Hebrew word, it means sit down and shut up. Wait. That's what it means. Like you wait for a doctor, you wait for a lawyer, you wait for some guy to see you, talk to you. Wait. You say, well, what do I do? Nothing. I mean, nothing. God is not blind. He can see you there. And as you wait, the flesh begins to wither away. Why do we wait? Because in waiting, the flesh begins to lose its force. So, let me just give you a few scriptures on this because it's so powerful. The second scripture I want to look at is Psalm 130, verse 5. It says, I wait for the Lord, my soul doth wait. Soul means my emotions, my intellect, my will come to a pause and I sit still. You have to understand how simple this is and how profound. So he said, I wait for the Lord, my soul doth wait. In his word do I hope. But I gotta wait. Then you have Psalm 25, verse 5. On thee do I wait. If it takes all day, who cares? Because he said it. Psalm 25, 5. Lead me in thy truth, teach me, for thou art the God of my salvation. On thee do I wait all the day. Now, God doesn't let you wait all day because he knows how impatient you are. So he shows up just before you crack. But you have to wait. Listen, listen. I have to do this. Because that's the only way I know how to touch God. You see, you cannot seek the Lord. That's impossible. In waiting, God quickens you to seek him. Because what waiting does, it enables God to quicken you. Psalm 80 verse 18 says, this is a powerful scripture. Psalm 80. 80 verse 18. Please put it on the screen for me. In the Psalms, David makes an amazing statement. He says, quicken me and then I will call on you. Quicken me. So now we will not go back from you. Quicken us and then we will call upon thy name. Well, you can't pray till God quickens you. But when does he quicken you? When you are completely quiet. You will know the moment he quickens you. But you say, what do I do? I mean, I get bored. No, I'll show you how to do it. It's so simple and marvelous, in fact. But let me just give you a few more scriptures. Isaiah 33, verse 2. Be gracious unto us, we've waited for you. See, God cannot show his grace without you waiting. You see, are you talking about what? I said, I'm talking about waiting. Just wait upon. Look, do you want to renew your strength or not? Do you want the power of God, yes or no? I'm giving you the secret. Wait. They that wait upon the Lord, Isaiah 40, shall renew their strength, and then they shall mount up with wings as eagles. They'll run, not be weary, and walk, and not faint, right? But you got to wait. You have to do it. You have no choice. The flesh will fight and hate and spit and scream. Don't worry about that. Just wait and let the flesh vanish. But the Bible, let me just see that. Isaiah 33, verse 2, all right? Oh, I see. You put that one. No, there it is. No, verse. That's correct. Thank you. That walk to go down into Egypt and have not asked at my mouth to strengthen themselves in the strength. I gave you the wrong. No, it's Isaiah 33, brother. 33. 33, verse 2. There we go. Lord, be gracious unto us. We have waited for you. Well, God cannot be gracious, nor can he be your strength from trouble unless you wait. And it says so right there. And then we read in Psalm 37, verse 7, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Now, think about what's at stake here. Without waiting, there's no power in your mouth. No power in your mouth. Angels are weakened in your behalf. Angels weakened, demons will be strengthened. And then you're ruined. Yet it all begins with waiting. Are you listening?
Yes, sir.
So when you wait, God empowers you. How? I'll tell you how. Because the fullness of the Spirit and our waiting are inseparable. They are linked together. And the reason God commands us to wait is because waiting empties us of self. Waiting enables us to receive God's fullness. Waiting quiets the soul. Waiting enables the Holy Ghost to touch our depth. Look at Psalm 42, 7 and 8 for a second. Psalm 42, 7 and 8. This is so powerful. Deep calls unto deep at the noise of thy water spouts. All thy waves and thy billows are gone over me. What does that mean? It means the presence of God like these water sprouts. Water sprouts basically are tornadoes in the ocean that suck the water right out. So when you begin to wait, God creates around you a water sprout. And you begin to be lifted into another realm. Now, here's how I do it. I'll show you. All right. I simply put some beautiful music on that touches my heart. Not things that mess up my head. And I just sit there. That's all. And I wait. 10 minutes. 15. I don't care. I just wait. And what do? I just listen to worship. You can't wait listening to rock music. You wait where the soul is able to get still. How many get it? Yeah.
Open
Close your eyes a second. Lift your hands.
We want to see Jesus. To reach out and touch Him. And say that we
Now you sit there for a few minutes and the songs continue. Lift your hands and love it. That's what I do, listening to these worship songs. And by the time this song starts, I'm in tears. Just listen, just a few more minutes. Why don't you lift your hands to heaven right now? Just wait a moment. By this time, I'm quickened. I just gave you a small little example. And when I'm quickened, at that moment, I can commune with the Lord. And so the scripture says, deep calls unto deep at the noise of thy water sprouts, thy billows, your waves have gone all over me. And then he said, for the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime. In the night his song shall be with me. Because the minute I'm quickened, it's ongoing quickening. It's not just for a few minutes. And suddenly, it's like the emptiness, the nothingness that has now become reality brings strength. Because in waiting, what happens in waiting? In waiting, our emptiness, our nothingness suddenly changes into strength. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Yeah. Because you reduce yourself in waiting. The soul now is stilled in waiting. I know this is not the kind of message some people want to hear, but if you really want the part of God, I'm giving you the secret. Because I've been there. Turn to Isaiah 30. Look at verse 15 with me. The scripture says, for thus saith the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest shall ye be saved, in quietness and in confidence shall be your strength. But you would not, you don't want it. You don't want to be quiet. What you want to do is be loud. That's not the way it works. A man named Peter Jaycock many years ago said to me, Benny, I'm going to pick you up at 5 in the morning. Make sure you're ready. So I said, all right, I'll be ready. 5 in the morning came. I'm out. I had no clue why them. And it's a mighty saint of God, great man of God, picked me up. This is 1972, somewhere there. I just got saved that year of 72. This had to be early 73. So now he picks me up at 5 in the morning, drives me to the forest outside Toronto, an hour drive, you're in no man's land. Now we're just trees everywhere. So he parks the car, we walk through the woods. And we walked for a good half hour. So now we're surrounded with trees and you name it, animals here and there and birds and whatever. And I walk in there, and then Peter says to me, I'll be right back. I thought, oh my God, where is he going? So I'm thinking he's going to go and do something behind the tree, you know, go to the bathroom. Now I'm standing in the forest by myself. Peter goes, and I'm thinking bathroom. But what he did is he went away and hid behind a large tree and watched me. Now I'm by myself. It's about 6:37 in the morning in a forest. Nobody there. 5 minutes pass. 10 minutes pass. 15 minutes pass. And I began to freak out. I said, the man left me. I'm going to die. I don't know my way back. He left and went to his car, and I'm in the wilderness, no way out, no way home. So I began screaming, Peter, where are you? He jumps from behind the tree, not far from me. He said, see, you cannot keep quiet for more than 15 minutes. I said, what did you bring me for? He said, I brought you here to teach you a lesson. I said, what lesson? And then he said this to me. He said, D.L. Moody said, if I can take a man and keep that man quiet for 5 minutes and have that man think about his soul, I'll get him saved. So say that again. He said, Benny, I brought you here to teach you the power of silence. He said, you could not keep quiet for too long. I said, you brought me to this forest at 5 in the morning? He said, I wanted you to remember that. And brother, I still remember it. And he said this to me. He was a mighty man of God. He said, D.L. Moody said, if I can take a man or a woman and keep them quiet for 5 minutes and let them think about their soul, I'll get them saved. The problem with us, nobody gets quiet long enough till it's too late. So the scripture has a lot to say about this. Verse 15, Isaiah 30, for thus saith, watch this, this is so powerful. For thus saith the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel. God is making a big announcement here. In returning and rest shall you be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. There's a lot in the Bible about this. Psalm 62. Turn with me. I'm showing you scriptures to prove to you my point. Because I believe if you start to do this today, by next week, you'll be a powerhouse. You know what I want? I want that when you walk into a room, all devils will leave like cowards. But you need the power of God on your life. Do you know that's what Catherine did? That's how she got the anointing, by being quiet. That's how Ari Tori did it. Oral Roberts, when Oral preached for me, he wouldn't even talk to me. He was sitting in my car, and I drove him to the service, and the man completely ignored I was even there. It bothered me at first, not now, because he was focused. When I had my crusades, I didn't talk to nobody. From 2 p.m. till 7, nobody even, I didn't even say hello to them. So that's rude. Oh no, that's what Jesus said. Don't say hello. On the way, salute no man. Be quiet. Because that's how power comes. Look, even the devil knows that stuff. That's how they do it in religions. They sit there and hum and be quiet for long periods, and then they do supernatural stuff that's all demonic. But what do they do first? Quiet. Because quietness empowers the spirit. Quietness stills the soul into emptiness and empowers the spirit. That's, listen, it's God who gave us that. He said, be still and know I am God. Yes. Psalm 46:10. Well, what is it to be still? Still is still. Do nothing but sit there. Listen. Help yourself with worship like I just showed you. Oh, how Paul would have wished he could have an iPhone. Think what Paul the Apostle would have done with an iPhone. Or a CD or an iPad to play music. Jean Guyon, a great woman of God back in France, would wait as she read the Bible. She would read the word and wait upon the Lord as she read the word very slowly. And then when she was quickened, she would cry out. And when she cried out, there was power. So in Psalm 62, verse 1 and verse 2, truly my soul waiteth upon God. From him comes my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation. He, my defense, I will not be moved. Why? I've been waiting. Truly my soul waits upon the Lord, because when I wait, I receive deliverance. He is my rock now because I've waited. He's my defense because I've waited. And because I've waited, nothing can shake me now. Waiting is our protection. Waiting is our defense. Waiting means the devil cannot touch us. The devil knows that. That's why he fights that area of your life very much. So it's in waiting that the soul sinks down into nothingness. It's in waiting that we are lifted up into God's divine presence. And only in waiting can God fulfill his promises. Because the multitude of words, the fervency of feelings in prayer have often been a hindrance, not a help. The more you talk, the more you lose. People enter into prayer, and they start, let thy words be few, the Bible says. How many are listening to me? Put your hands up high. Wait. And when you wait, he'll quicken you. And when he quickens you, true prayer begins, not just empty words. Empty words will wear you out. You come into prayer, Lord, you've got this long list of prayer thing, and by the time you're done, you are worn out. Well, who wants to go back and do the same thing tomorrow? If you get worn out, you don't want to do that again. Are you listening? You see, these prayer meetings, people have prayer meetings, they wear themselves out by screaming and hollering and jumping and singing, but there's no prayer. It's just all flesh. It's all activity, and there's flesh. There's no power there. Waiting upon the Lord means be still till God quickens you, and once he quickens you, prayer will be born, and when prayer is born by the Spirit, there'll be power. And so the Bible has a lot to say about this. So the Word of God says, be silent. Why? Because silence brings the infilling of the Spirit. Silence is the door to the power of God. And Zechariah 2:13 says that. Look at Zechariah 2:13. We'll look at it on the screen. I'm almost done. I had to get this through to you because I really want you to know the presence of God. And the presence of God will never be known by noise. The presence of God is known by stillness. Be still, then you'll know me. If you're not still, you'll never know me. Be still, you'll receive strength. You're not still, there's no strength. It's that simple. Nobody teaches on this today. Why? Because nobody wants to bother with it. Thank God your pastor, I'm sure, teaches on this, and other pastors do. But this is God's word that I'm giving you. So Zechariah 2:13, it says, be silent, all flesh, before the Lord, because when you're silent, he will get up out of his holy habitation. Silence moves the hand of God. Silence moves him into action for his people. It's in the word. That's how the greats found the power. When Catherine Kuhlman would preach, she preached so much on this, about death to self and silence and submission of the flesh. Today all you hear, you can make it, you're a winner, and it's all about you, not about Jesus. That's all you hear. I tormented myself not long ago to watch TBN. I tormented myself to watch a preacher on TV who's very famous. And I sat for half an hour tormenting my soul just to see what he has to say. And all he said is how you can make it and you can win, and you never said Jesus one time. It's all about you. I thought to myself, you know what? If I was going through my divorce again, I need that message. If I had a problem, a lawsuit, it's a good message to encourage me. But if my son or my daughter or a family member died, it'll crumble so fast. If I had a real tragedy, that message has no meaning to me. Why? Because there's no Jesus in it. It's all about you can make it, you can win, God is on your side, all that empty stuff, but no Jesus. When I got saved, all I heard is, give it to Jesus. Die to yourself. Catherine Kuhlman would come on the platform, you gotta die, you gotta die. And I'm thinking, what does she mean by you gotta die? I was so stupid, I would go home and say, Father, please kill me. I died a thousand deaths before I walked up on this platform. I had no clue what she said. You gotta die. Corrie ten Boom. You remember Corrie ten Boom? How many knew who Corrie ten Boom was? How many have no clue who Corinth Tambo was? Hiding place. You've heard of the story Hiding Place? That's Corinth Tambo. I danced with her. I was 19 years old and I danced with Corinth Tambo. I went to her house because I was friends with her nephew, Danilo. And in her home, she grabbed my cheek. She said, "Where did you get this face?" I said, "Israel." She said, "Shalom." All she talked about, all Corey talked about was dying to self and living for Jesus. Today you don't hear that stuff. All you hear is about you, 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 me, 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 flesh, 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 and nobody has power. The anointing comes when you wait upon the Lord. The Holy Ghost shows up when you wait upon the Lord. The glory comes when you wait upon the Lord. Not upon yourself and your own strength. There's no strength in you anyways. So the message of yesterday needs to be preached today. Give it to Jesus. Call upon Jesus. It's all about Jesus, not me, not you. And that's when you get filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, there's two ways to be filled with the Holy Ghost. One, I think is dangerous, and one, I think is safe. You can be filled with the Holy Spirit in a group, in a church, where there's a great move of God, but that's dangerous because that infilling came because of people around you, and you are dependent now on getting filled only in a revival meeting. But there's another way to get filled, in quietness. That's the safe way to get filled. When you're in the presence of God and you're not dependent on the emotions of the crowd. Did you hear what I said? So some people will be filled, but they need a service, a prayer meeting, a revival to go to, which means the infilling is dependent on some service they have to go to. I don't need services to get filled. I be filled when I'm in my room listening to these songs I just played. And when I walk out, I'm like a giant. Because now the power of God is all over me. And now, come back there, Roberto, you and Gregory. The power of God, that blessed stillness. You can play now. That blessed stillness in His presence will cause worship. Worship is not praise. Worship brings forth the voice of God, Psalm 95. The Father seeks those who worship in spirit and truth, John 4. The minute I am still, now I come to my highest call. My highest call is worship. I was created for worship. It's the greatest expression of love. All the exercises of the Christian life, prayer, love, faith, surrender, obedience, really culminates in worship. Your whole being is now caught in worship. You come to the truest, fullest meaning of love. It's our highest destiny, worship. Worship begins in stillness. God created the soul, the seat of our personality, this the seat of our consciousness. But the soul must be stilled because it cannot worship. Worship is spirit. Worship is not soul. And when we worship, the soul now submits to the spiritual realm rather than the physical realm. You see, when I don't worship, the soul is pulled into the flesh and the realm of the flesh. So it submits to the flesh. When I worship, it submits to the spirit. And now it's controlled by the spirit. So I start with stillness. And I start with stillness and quietness. God quickens me. The Song of Solomon 1:4 says, draw me and then I'll run after you. So in quietness, God quickens us. Psalm 80 verse 18. In quietness, we are drawn. In quietness, we are welcomed. In quietness, we are invited into the royal presence of God. And when that happens, prayer begins. And when prayer begins, it begins with wealth and meaning. There's no empty, forgive me, bless me, amen, and you repeat yourself. And then you enter into an amazing realm. It's really the tabernacle all over again. It's the seven roadmaps into God's presence. Because we all have to be in at the gate. And from the gate, we move in. So when you get on your knees, here's what happens. Watch me. Can I get a chair? Can I get your chair? Put it right there. Now, this is the presence of the Lord. And this is where I begin. So this is a good hour from here to there, most times, at least an hour. So you have to give that to the Lord. If you don't, no power. So I start. Now this I do every day. And the day I don't, I lose. So I get into my prayer room and I wait. What I'm not aware of is as I'm waiting and I'm playing this music that you heard earlier, I'm getting closer, but I'm not realizing I'm getting closer because there's nothing going on. The flesh is fighting. The flesh is fighting because my mind is worn out. My body's worn out. I'm yawning. I get hungry. I want to do this. I want to do that because the flesh fights. But the longer I wait, the closer I get. And halfway is breaking point. Halfway is where I'm quickened. But I'm not realizing I'll be quickened. So now I've been here for 20 minutes. And I'm not saying a whole lot. And if I say something, I'm actually a hindrance to the Spirit. So I got to be quiet. I have to do what the Bible says. I simply am quiet. Quiet means quiet. So there's worship playing in my room because I have an iPad, or I connect my phone to a speaker through Bluetooth. And I'm just waiting. About this right here, my stomach starts to want food. And I'm really getting tired, and I'm wondering if God is watching, is he paying attention? Now, if I say, well, you know what, I maybe better go get a glass of water, and maybe I'll feel better. What I don't know is I cannot get back into that position. I start here all over again. So a glass of water had just cost me half an hour. So I have to wait till I break through. 40 minutes have passed and nothing has happened that I can tell. But God is doing it and I'm not able because it's all spirit. The flesh cannot see the difference. Now suddenly, without me knowing, about here, I start crying. Tears are the sign of quickening. How many have had that happen to you? Put your hands up high. When that happens, everything changes. Now I call Jesus with truth. Over here, I was humming things and mumbling stuff and repeating stuff, and finally I got quiet long enough that God could quicken me. Because the more you talk, the more he does nothing. If you talk, he will not move. Because he said in his word, be still. And be still means be quiet. So now I'm quickened. When I'm quickened, what I don't understand or realize is I pass from the outer court to the holy place. In the holy place, I praise. And when I praise, everything in me now explodes. It's now the seeking realm. Over here was the asking realm. Remember Jesus said, ask, seek, knock. Here is the seeking realm where I'm seeking the Lord now, and my heart explodes for Jesus. And as I now about 45, 50 minutes, And at this point, it feels like I've been in only 3 minutes because now time means nothing. Over there, it meant everything. Over here means nothing. And finally, about an hour, sometimes an hour and 15, I'm here. I'm completely wrapped in glory. At this point, there's such fellowship and such beauty. It's like I'm reborn. And when I leave this spot here, which has happened many times, anyone who sees me says, you've been with the Lord, because they can tell everything is calm. And the thing is, your words are different. Now you love your enemies. Over there you hated them, now you love them. Because without the presence of God, you can't love nobody. Now you forgive so easy. Over there you wanted to kill them all. Here you forgive them all. Because now God's presence made the difference. And now you can minister and bless people's lives, and peace will fill your soul all day long, and you go in your car and you're singing all the way on the 405 with traffic everywhere. And you sing in the shower, and you are so peaceful. Nothing can shake you. An earthquake can hit and nobody cares. You don't care because peace that passeth all understanding. And now the power of God is reality. Please stand up. It all begins with quietness. Lift your hands to heaven and let's bless His name. Because what God is looking for is you come to that place of Psalm 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And there you will say, I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge, my rock. In Him I trust.
We proclaim Your name is exalted, for You reign magnificent. You rule victorious. Your power is known throughout the earth. And we exclaim that You are mighty. Lift up Your name, Lord. For You are holy. We sing it again. All honor and glory. In adoration, we bow before Your throne.
Another 30 seconds, just keep praying.
We declare Your majesty. We proclaim Your name is exalted, for You reign magnificent. You rule victorious. Your power is known throughout the earth. And we exclaim, You are so mighty. Lift up Your name. You are so holy. We sing it again. All honor, all glory. In adoration, we bow before Your throne. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. I want you all now, lift your hands to heaven. Let's praise His name. Sing along with me. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.